Good morning. We welcome you here to Liberty Baptist Church. And we're looking forward at the end of the service to recognize all of our school staff personnel, active or retired, okay? So we're going to do that at the end of the service. Want to say thank you to all of our folks that came to Sunday school, 122 today. So hopefully we'll see that keep creeping up into the 130s and on and on and on. We want to remind the Vision Committee of their meeting tomorrow night, 6 p.m. Rock and CCC, if it's not raining, we haven't been rained out yet, Tuesday night, 6:45. On Wednesday night, we have prayer meeting, and then there's going to be a little bit of a schedule change for the youth and the children. Kenny and Jennifer Brewer are going to have all those kids over to their house for a bonfire, and they're just going to have a time of fellowship over there at the house. So looking forward to seeing how they enjoy that. And then you'll notice that we have a thank you in the bulletin for all the people that came to our work day or helped with some of the activities for the work day. And I made a mistake. I said with 13 acres. Well, 13 acres is just this part back here. So there's 18 acres, okay? So there is a lot of work to do. And I know there's got to be two or three people in our congregation who are gifted in trimming hedge. And the reason that that spiritual gift is needed is the activity center needs, the hedge over there need a haircut badly. So if you have that spiritual gift, I would ask that you would pray the Lord to show you when you need to do that, sometime between now and maybe a week before homecoming, which is the last Sunday in September. And if you could do that, we would greatly appreciate it. You don't have to have permission unless you did a bad job. Then we'll ask, why didn't you ask about that? So if you want to be sure, we can give you some instructions about how far to trim it down. But that is something that really needs to be done, and it can be done any day of the week except Sunday, of course. Okay? All righty. We're going to have a time of prayer as we begin our service this morning, and we want to mention two prayer concerns. We need to remember Tom Beach's brother, Tracy. He had a heart attack and is over at Methodist Medical Center. They've installed a stent. He's in intensive care and is doing well, so we're thankful that they were able to intervene. And then the hurricane and the situation in Texas is something that we really need, I think, to keep in our prayers. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come here today thankful for the blessings of this day. We're thankful, Heavenly Father, for school being back in session and just seeing all the routines kind of getting back in place. We're thankful that you were with Daniel as he had his tonsils taken out this past week. And Lord, just pray that he'll continue to get better. We also pray, Heavenly Father, that you will be with Mr. Beach as he goes through this time of recuperation, recovery from his procedure. And we ask, Heavenly Father, for all of the folks that are in Texas that are being impacted by this storm. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will help people to make good decisions about what to do, about where they ought to be in the event of flooding. We also pray for all the disaster relief people that will be going in the days and weeks ahead, Lord, to give them protection and to provide the means for them to be able to help that part of Texas get back on its feet. We pray, Heavenly Father, as we come here this morning, that you would encourage us with your presence and your love, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. The pastor mentioned about being gifted in trimming hedges, and it got me to thinking, you know, I think we may have a few people in our congregation who are gifted in cutting hair. And I would assume that cutting hair is much like trimming hedges, just with bigger scissors, right? So maybe I'm seeing a lot of heads shaking no for Well, I was trying, Pastor. I was really trying to help. If you change your mind, just let me or the pastor know, and we'll be happy to get you those trimmers. If you would, I encourage you to stand as we sing hymn number 136, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. Number 32, come Christians, join to sing. join us as we sing hymn number 315, His Name is Wonderful. Sing hymn number 557. I love you, Lord, and you are precious.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on our service here this morning. Lord, we thank you for all your blessings on us, the seen and the unseen, how you take care of us from day to day. Lord, thank you. Bless these tithes and offerings. Bless Pastor Paul as he leads us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Kathy. I invite you to turn in your Bibles, the book of Revelation, chapter 3. We're going to be looking at the church at Philadelphia, the letter that was sent to that church. And the Greek, Philadelphia, is translated brotherly love. So you hear about Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the city of brotherly love. It goes all the way back to Asia Minor, that name. Let's remember that Jesus was speaking these messages to these churches and the people within the church, the Christians who are in that church, and sometimes the people who are not very faithful in that church. And so we hear again, and the angel of, and to the angel, meaning the pastor of the church in Philadelphia, write, "These things says he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God and the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from God, and I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, help us that as we come here this morning, that we could recognize that you can use us no matter how weak we are, that you can make a difference in this world through us. And help us, Heavenly Father, to listen and obey, to hear your words, to have ears that hear your love, your words, your commandments. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. When weakness is strength. People don't go around saying, "I hope I can be weak, that way I'll be strong." That doesn't make sense logically. But what we see throughout the New Testament is that when people are willing to acknowledge their weakness and need for God, that's when God can use them. I came across this story. It occurred in April of 2013. This event actually occurred on April the 1st. There was a man out in Oregon who was working on his tractor and somehow got pinned underneath his tractor. So he started calling out for help. And his two teenage daughters heard him and ran to where he was, and he was pinned underneath the tractor. He couldn't even breathe. So this 16-year-old and this 13-year-old girl grab a hold of this tractor, and they lift it up. Well, they could only hold it up for a few seconds, but it gave him enough time to catch his breath. So then they had to, I don't know if they dropped, they let it back down. And so then he says, "Do it again. That helped. So they lifted again on this ton-and-a-half tractor, and he was actually, their father was actually able to kind of scoot out a little bit, but then when they let it down, it pinned his arm. So the older one went to get help, and the younger one started digging dirt out from underneath her dad's arm, and it relieved the pressure. So then the neighbor came, and he had some equipment, and they got the tractor off. They sent him to the hospital, and the wife and the mom receives this phone call on April Fool's Day. Your husband got pinned under a tractor, but he's okay. The daughters helped lift the tractor off of him, and he's going to be in the emergency room. Is this an April Fool's joke? No, it is not. You need to get to the hospital immediately. And all he suffered was a broken wrist. That was it. Well, the question, of course, comes to your mind. Well, were these girls weightlifters or what? You know, what was going on there? They were able to lift that tractor, which was an impossible task. They were able to help their father survive a terrible accident because they loved him. That's why. And we need to remember that when we go out and do things with love in our hearts, as we're commanded to do, we will be able to do very difficult, even impossible tasks because God is going to empower our weakness. God is going to give us the strength to do whatever we need to do in order to further His kingdom's work. Think about Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, a place where they had experienced earthquakes, a place where they had strong persecution against the Christians, and even the Jews who were in the synagogue there were involved in that persecution. This church felt weak, inadequate, unable to be the witness that they needed to be there in Philadelphia. And so Christ sends this message of affirmation to them, saying, keep working, keep persevering, I know what you're doing, you're going to conquer. I believe that for many discouraged Christians these days, you need to hear that message too. That God can take your weakness, your inadequacies, and that He can make a difference in this world through you. So first of all, we have affirmations about who Christ is. Each of the letters kind of, it's a way of pointing out that this is indeed Christ who is addressing the Christians in that city. So we're told some things about Jesus Christ. First of all, He is holy. There is an affirmation of the divinity of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was not only a good teacher, not only a good prophet, He was the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, divine co-creator in the universe. And so there is no diminishing of who Christ is. And then it says simply, He who is true. Well, it's really He who is truth. And what are we told in John chapter 14, verse 6? We're told that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. That is telling us not only about the exclusivity of how we receive eternal life, but it also tells us that Christ is truth itself. And do we believe and do we trust in Him? Then He says, He who has the key of David, He who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. Now this is a reference to Isaiah 22:22. And we should have it up here on the screen for you, but if Isaiah is one of the bigger prophets, he's a little bit easier to find than Habakkuk, okay? Habakkuk is not, you know, one of those, you know, books that, you know, that pops up at you. And if you have small print on mine, it's only a page. It's really hard to find. But Isaiah, this is making a reference to Eliakim, who was the head treasurer of the house of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a very faithful king of the lineage of David, which means that Hezekiah was part of the lineage and heritage of Jesus in terms of his genealogy through Mary. So he has this key, and one of the things Hezekiah did was Hezekiah brought back temple worship. He was one of the best kings that ever existed in Judah. And one of the things he did was he reminded the people, you need to be supporting the temple work and the priest. And so they actually had to build these storerooms as part of the temple complex to be able to bring in the offerings that had not been brought in the past. And so Eliakim was the one who held this key. And look at what it says here in 22. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder, for he shall open and no one shall shut. So Jesus is reminding them about the authority of the keys to the kingdom of heaven. In Revelation chapter 1, we go back a couple of chapters, you will see again this concept of keys. Of course, we all see it in Matthew 16, but I mean, we could just go on and on with all references, but you can look up Matthew 16 and see what Jesus says to Peter. All right? Revelation 1:18, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forever. Talking about his resurrection. Amen, he says. Yes, indeed. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and death. The key that once he can only one to open it, and then when it's shut, it can't be shut. See? Talking about the authority to consign all those who are evil and Satan and his minions to hell. Keys are important. Keys give you lawful entry into a building. Okay? And I've also heard it said that keys are only for honest men because dishonest men don't worry about keys. And that's probably true. When I was at the seminary several decades ago, I worked on the paint crew. And we had this maintenance building. And in that maintenance building, you had the electricians, you had the plumbers, you had the carpenters, and you had the painters. The ground crew had a separate building right across the road from us. And so in this building, there was in the office this key box. Okay, now think about it. You got, 15 plus buildings, okay? And so this key box, I don't even remember how big it was. So since you weren't there, I'll just say it was from here to here, okay? That was the footprint on the wall. Well, then the doors opened up and it expanded even further. And I mean, there was these pegs. There was key after key after key after key. And Don Melton, I believe was his name, if I remember correctly. He was the head of maintenance. And we all envied him because he had what they called the granddaddy key. It fit, I won't say it fit every lock in every building, but it just about fit all of them. Even our paint foreman, he had a big old thing of keys. And, kids like to play with keys because, it gives them a sense of authority. And so we just rekeyed some of the locks over at the activity center. And I've got that's not as many as I used to have, but I have so many keys that are of a sledge variety that I was like, I need something to help me to know which one is the key to the activity center. So I had them do a UT key. See? Any of y'all have one of those? It's kind of cool. So now when I'm going over the activity centers, I just pull that one out. Keys are a sense of authority and one of power. You got one? No, you got an Alabama key. Yeah, I know what type of key you got. That's what you call a mixed marriage, UT and Alabama, right? Okay. But it's the authority that a key brings. Jesus has that key, the key to eternal life, the key to a meaningful life, but also the key to death and Hades, hell and Hades. So it's Christ that is addressing this church. Now, there's many positives that are shared in these verses. First of all, he says, I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door that no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. An open door. An open door to witness. Maybe they're weak, But the fact is that there is not that hindrance. Christ has opened the door, has made it possible for them to be witnesses. And with that open door, they are to go out and to share the good news. When we go out these doors into the lobby and then out into the parking lot, that's an open door. It's not locked. In fact, if the door is locked from the outside, it's got a panic bar, you can get out. It's an open door, no matter when you're here, no matter if anyone else is here. It's an open door. Do we take advantage of the open doors that we have? There will be some Sundays that when we go out these doors, you're going to hear referee whistles just right across the fence. An open door. We are serving the school. We're going to be taking a light meal over there on Thursday, a week from now, in order to show the faculty and staff we're concerned for them as they're having their conferences that afternoon and evening. An open door. Maybe we have just a little bit of power, but that's all we need, because the most important power that we have is our power to say yes to God, to say amen to God. Because if we'll just yield ourselves, God can use us. And then Jesus talks about, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet to know that I have loved you. The passage that I thought would be good to look at would be John chapter 10. I just opened up Habakkuk. That's amazing. Okay, I'll go back this way. I can't believe it. Okay. John chapter 10. In this whole part of John's gospel, there's this debate between the Jewish leaders and Jesus about who are you and why are you here and how can you claim to be divine? And don't you know Abraham is our father and who are you? And they even make some disparaging remarks about the suspicious circumstances of his birth. Do not think that Jesus, being born of a virgin, that the Jews didn't see that as truth, but they knew there was something strange going on, that the marriage had to be hurried up between Mary and Joseph, and they knew about that. And Israel was a small place. The rumors got around. So, in chapter 10, verse 16, Jesus says, he's the good shepherd, and then he says, and other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. And Jesus is making a very important statement here that, yes, I have come to my people, the people of Israel, God's chosen people. I've come to let them know about the good news of God and the way of salvation, but they're not the only ones a part of the sheepfold. In fact, there's only going to be one sheepfold. There's only going to be one group of sheep. And those other sheep are the Gentiles. And there's going to be one flock, one shepherd. Let me tell you something. The Jews did not want to hear this, and they did not believe it. And we're told that one day, and there's several references in the Bible, about how the Jews will come and bow at the feet of those who are reigning with Christ. Also, as we go back to Revelation chapter 3, Jesus talks about how, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. To me, as I interpret this particular verse, I think it is saying very clearly that the church will be raptured before the tribulation. There is a protection for those who are in Christ. That rapture will occur, and then there will be that time of trial, that time of terrible suffering. And there will be some people who are on the church rolls that when Christ comes back will not go up with Christ. because they really were not saved. They just thought they were saved. And to me, that is the most terrible lie of Satan. Oh, well, you said the right words and you walked the aisle and you got dipped in the pool or in the pond or in the river, in the stream, so you must be saved. You're only saved if you have a personal saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And today, if you have doubts about whether you're saved or not, I do not want you walking out of this building without having the assurance that you are saved. That if something happened to you tonight, that you would be in heaven and not in hell. There was a gentleman, and I've told you about him, Mr. White, who was in his 70s, who was an ordained deacon, and he kept coming and talking to me about all of his doubts. And I said, well, I'm going to pray with you, but I don't want you to make this decision for it to be emotional. I want you to be convicted by God that this is what you need to do to be baptized again. And on an Easter morning, he came forward and he said, I am not at peace. I need to have peace. I know that I'm not saved. I need you to pray for me right now, and then I need to be baptized as soon as possible, in his 70s. But he put that pride aside, and he put the fact he was an ordained deacon aside, and he wanted to be sure that he was right with God. And let me tell you something. When he came up out of the baptismal waters, that smile was so big. I mean, it was so radiant because he knew that he had done what he needed to do. Oh, my friends, don't live in doubt. Don't let something human keep you from doing what God wants you to do. Now, as we get to the negatives, there are none. Isn't that great? Smyrna and Philippi, those churches, only positive commendations, only positive statements. I tell you what, when they get to heaven, I bet Jesus said, well, well done, my good and faithful servant. They had done so well. Works don't save you, but works determine your rewards. And how we live our life right now, are we taking advantage of the open doors of evangelism that we have? Are we living our lives in a way that would please God and demonstrates a holiness in our lives and a desire to grow into the image of Christ? We need to be strong. We need to persevere. We need to strive towards holiness. And then this letter ends with exhortation and reward. Some of these rewards are contextual with that city. Really, all the letters are. So first he says, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. Because this area of the world is prone to earthquakes, there was concern about where is stability? How will the buildings hold up? And so as they rebuilt after one earthquake that occurred not too far before this letter was written, they would put a lot of pillars in their buildings. And if you were an honorable citizen of that town, maybe you helped donate money, you would actually have your name written on a pillar. And we use that term. They were a pillar of the church. Or they're a pillar of our family. Or they were a pillar of our school. Meaning, they were rock solid. You could count on them. That's what Christ is saying. You're going to be a pillar in the temple of God. And you won't have to go out after an earthquake or something bad happens. You're going to be able to dwell there. And then it says, I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. All these new names. We know in the Bible that the new name represented a new future, a new hope, a new blessing from God. So Abram became Abraham, a father of nations. And Simon, son of Bar-Jonah, or Simon, son of Jonah, Bar-Jonah, he became Simon Peter, Simon Petros, Simon the Rock. the guy that was hot-headed and unstable, he became the rock. Wouldn't that be great if we too could be ones to whom God puts His new name, His new blessing on? He'll do that if we will be obedient to Him. Yes, in our weakness, God could be made strong. I want to talk about a person who was weak in many ways. We know her very well, Lottie Moon. When I thought about strength and weakness, I thought about Lottie Moon. In 1872, her sister had actually gone to China as a Southern Baptist missionary, and she wrote back to her family about the dire needs there in China for Christian missionaries. And so while listening to a sermon on John 4:23 about the fields are wide unto harvest, Lottie felt this undeniable call to go to China. And so at age 32, she sailed to China, and she went and she learned the language. She even took on the dress of the ladies that lived there in China. She taught school for a while, but then at age 45, she gave up teaching, became a full-time missionary. And it's kind of funny about missionaries is that they do things in other countries they're not allowed to do here in the United States. So Lottie Moon preached and she baptized. So, you know, figure that out. And she did a wonderful job of converting thousands and thousands of Chinese to the gospel. She sent back correspondence to America about the great needs that were there in China. And as a result, people started taking up money in order to support not only the work in China, but other missionaries. And so they named the missionary offering after her. That started in 1888. And now millions of dollars are taken up in her name at Christmas time to support our missionaries. And Joelle and I are so thankful because our son and daughter-in-law and two granddaughters, yes, I have pictures, but we won't do that right now, but they receive so much help because of that Christmas offering. Here was this little frail lady who went and had a tremendous impact. God used her weakness and made it strength. When she was 72 years old, she was starting to get very sick because there was a drought that then resulted in a famine there in China. And so she would not take her normal portion of rice and other food. She gave that away, and it caused her to become very ill. And so she started back in 1912 on a ship headed back to the United States. But 4 days into that voyage, she died. My friends, you can look at your weaknesses, your past sins, your frailties. You can all day long talk about that to the Lord. But what He's going to tell you is that if you will hear my voice, if you will obey my commands, I will take your weaknesses, your frailties, and I will turn that into a glorious witness for my kingdom. My friends, let's don't make excuses. Let's be an example of how God's power can change a life. Let's bow in prayer together. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this great testimony that we have from the church at Philadelphia. The great strength that they demonstrated, though they were weak. Lord, help us to live lives that have that type of positive impact. And I would pray this morning, Heavenly Father, that if there's someone here that does not know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, I pray that today that they would recognize that one day there is a judgment, that one day they will have to answer for their life? And do they want to answer alone, or do they want to have Jesus Christ as their defense attorney? Heavenly Father, help us always to be your people who are demonstrating your love to this dying world, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. This morning we open the doors of our church. It's the opportunity to respond to how God is working in your life, being obedient to His voice.